Sorry about that. You know, when I got the invitation to be part of this panel, I almost decided to say no. For one major reason, what has Industrial Revolution got to do with me and the marginalized South? But upon thinking about it, I thought that's the reason why I should come here, to ask all of you guys, what's that got to do with us in the South? We're not into Industrial Revolution, we're into actual revolution. Yes. Right? And I was very happy to hear actually the discussion by Secretary De La Peña, because a lot of the things he said would relate to the needs of the South. But yung kay Ace Caldaba, yung Evita, medyo, parang Metro Manila, Davao, hubs lang yun. But anyway, let me just say, to begin with, last night, I was at a debriefing dinner with the Ramon Magsaysay awardees. We have six of them this year. I'm on the board of the Ramon Magsaysay Awards Foundation. Our awardees this year, two are from India. One is a prosperous psychiatrist who has decided to spend a lot of his time, both he and his wife are psychiatrists, and they spend a lot of their time dealing with the mentally incapacitated people in India who just wander about. And he's been doing this for over a decade. So you see somebody who is the result of technology in education, but putting his skills in face-to-face, physical contact kind of technology to improve the conditions that he saw. The other Indian fellow, Sonam, who is from northern India, a very marginalized and depressed community, region called Ladakh. It's another interesting fellow. He's an engineer who has actually spent most of his time trying to reform the educational system of his community and succeeded in actually reforming the entire region's educational system by making education more attentive and more responsive to the needs of his community, not to the needs of a global, highly technological community. This guy, Sonam, is really interesting, and I really want to go up to Ladakh, northern India, to visit him, except he says I have to hike 4 hours to get to his school. But one of the things he did, which I found so remarkable, he's up in northern India, near the Himalayas. So imagine winter. And as it turns out, his people, every winter, they create, it's like an ice castle. It's an ice stupa. So it's a small, the people create a small stupa for their, I guess, rituals. But he thought, I can do something with this. Because if I can make it in such a way that I can retain it and it will melt slowly, that addresses the water needs of my community. So guess what? Over the last 10 years, he finally was able to create giant stupas, 6 of them. And these stupas, he positions near the community, and all through spring, it melts slowly. And the water, thousands of gallons of water, irrigates the community. So, low tech. So, Industrial Revolution, what has that got to do with us? And is government wisely positioned to invest so much effort on Industrial Revolution when it will not touch many of us? Let me tell you exactly why. Secretary De La Peña was talking about inequality versus equality and the possibility inequality instead of closing the gap. Well, let me just say that I'm really no stranger to technology and AI, thanks to children. That's what we do, right? Something goes wrong with your iPhone or your Mac, give it to your kid and they're going to fix it. So my kids are the ones who introduced me to the idea of big data, artificial intelligence, and all of that. They're so comfortable with technology, just like all millennials are. They dragged me to watch the movie where the hero gets into the virtual reality and, you know, saves virtual reality world and real world. Then you start thinking about situations like that and whether this is something that could happen to the Philippines in the future. Of course, it's within the realm of possibility, but maybe only in some areas. Because let's take a look at Mindanao. There are two Mindanaos. There is the highly developed, rich, good educational indicators Mindanao, that's the Christian Mindanao. And there's the other Mindanao, marginalized, poorest of the poor, conflict affected, least served Mindanao. And that's the Mindanao of the Baksamoro and the indigenous peoples. And just in case you think that that's a small percentage of population, you've got another thing coming. Between the Muslims, the Baksamoro tribes, and the indigenous peoples groups, we should account for easily out of 25 million population or 30 million population of Mindanao, we are probably at this point 25% of the population. Okay, so you have 25%, one fourth of Mindanao is not going to be participating in your industrial revolution, in the fourth industrial revolution. One fourth. Let's take a look at that one fourth. And here, love maybe may find this of particular interest. My mother, former Senator Santanina Rasul, her advocacy is adult literacy. Because our home province of Sulu had the highest illiteracy, adult illiteracy rate in the whole country. And the one who pointed this out to her was former Secretary Paeng Salas when he was still working with the UN. So she resolved to do something about it and look for a Jurassic way of teaching adult literacy, because that's the only way it can prosper where we are. Then she developed one, and it cost 5,000 pesos only to convert a zero literacy individual to functional literacy after 3 to 4 months, 10 hours a day, 10 hours a week. So you in NCR will think, madali lang yun. Because here, what is the illiteracy rate in NCR? Less than 10%? Well, let me tell you this. In ARMM, when we did as a estimate of our own, we estimated adult illiteracy in ARMM, Sulu, Tawi-Tawi, Pasilan, Lano del Sur, Maguindanao, to be about 500,000 adults, about a third of the labor force. And then I became part of the advisory council of the 4Ps, the Conditional Cash Transfers Program of ESWT. And their data showed me I was off the mark. It was more like a million. A million adults in Muslim Mindanao, I'm not including the illiterate adults in the indigenous people's community or in the Christian rural community. Okay, so how does your industrial revolution touch them? If we are going to be looking at government policy, it is well and good to invest in research, in grants for the improvement of industrial, the fourth industrial revolution in universities, etc. But requirements of this other group, this other part of our population. And I'm not saying this because it's, well, of course, it's the right thing to do, but that's not the only reason. The other major reason is if you don't do this, then you are going to create the inequality. You're going to widen the inequality, and at this point in time, we cannot afford that. Because the other group that's using social media to great effect has found its way to Malawi. And that group is called ISIS. ISIS knows how to use social media in a way that governments don't, and even civil society don't. So if they're doing this and being able to access our young, why are we not doing more to make our communities resilient? And an easy, low-hanging fruit type of endeavor to add to resiliency is to make the adults literate. I mean, come on, that's not rocket science. It's so obvious. It amazes me why government does not do it. At 5,000 pesos per adult, come on. So literacy, education, clearly is important for us. If we're just going to make sure that whatever investment we have in industrial revolution also does not take away from the need to help the other Mindanao. Another issue that I thought we should be looking at, the World Bank had developed, well, did a research for almost 2 years, the Mindanao Jobs Report. And I was on the advisory group for the Mindanao Jobs Report. For the entire Mindanao, the needs of industrial revolution is not that prioritized. What is prioritized really is agriculture, aquaculture, processing. And here again, you're going to need sustainable and appropriate technology. And I don't think Sophia and Alexa and Dr. Google will be of much use. Because if you look at the requirements of the entire Mindanao, you will still find that we are lacking the needed infrastructure, not just for the Industrial Revolution, but of developing agriculture and the other sectors. And what are those? Electricity, water, ports. So at the policy level, you really have to start balancing the requirements. Now, lastly, I said that in Muslim Mindanao, the Industrial Revolution may not really be appropriate. But let me tell you the result of a survey that we developed with SWS. You can download it on their website. This was last April. Mm-hmm. And we wanted to look at how what was going on in the conflict-affected areas, especially with the entry of violent extremism. Mm-hmm. So of course, we wanted to find out, are they accessing social media? Mm-hmm. Well, this is the interesting thing. In the evacuation camps, in the IDP, the displaced people's camps, 36% said that they access social media. How do they do that? They're homeless. They're using precious limited funds to access social media on their cell phones. And even more interesting, their percentage of usage was higher than the percentage from our survey group from the entire Lanao del Sur province. So why are they doing this? Well, you can rightfully say escape from reality. But there's also the other question, is somebody else accessing them? So working on the demands, the needs of the other Mindanao, even if it does not further the need to support and strengthen our entry into the fourth industrial revolution cannot be neglected. And it's not because